morning, ladies and gentlemen. So the title of my presentation is Aesthetic of Wearable Robotics, Symbiosis Possible. And I will speak about why wearable robots, so which are the motivations that motivate us to continue this difficult and critical research, and what are our goals for the future. And I will speak about wearability, symbiosis, aesthetics, and the ultimate goal of rehabilitation, which is our research area, and it is called rehabilitation engineering. And I will speak about exoskeleton, what is an exoskeleton, and the main activities for designing a really wearable exoskeleton, personal assistance and rehabilitation, and the meaning of personal assistance and rehabilitation. And I will also speak about prosthetics, and I will show some recent results in this area, with the achievement of our group, and the future perspectives of this research area. So first of all, why wearable robots? This is a video, it is performed in the United States, and it is a collaboration between the United States and Germany. And it is a work by Okerberg and colleagues, and it shows a subject with tetraplegia and an implant in the central nervous system, an interface, and she is able to control the reaching of the bottle and then the drinking of the liquid from the bottle, and then she controls the face of going back to the table. And look at her face. What is important for us is the smile of the subject after being successful in reaching the objective of this task. So this is our motivation. So the subject with severe impairments motivate us to continue in this research. And the main objective is to restore for subject with this severe impairment the ability of going back to activities of daily living. This is a very extreme case, and there are other cases which are at least as important as this. And the second motivation is the growth of the percentage of people, of elderly people in our society. This projection shows us that in Italy, in Japan, in Korea, in the Far East, in Europe, in several countries, the number, the percentage of population with, who is more than 65 years old is increasing. And so we know that because there are several investigations on age-related reduction of cognitive abilities, that not only the physical abilities, so the motor abilities of this subject, but also the cognitive abilities of these subjects are reduced, and we know that, so we must deal with this kind of population and provide solutions for this kind of subjects. So we know that the number of people with 100% of abilities is decreasing fast, going to population with who is more than 85 years old. So this is the scenario for our research. We want to provide some new tools, new systems for this population in order to provide them with the possibilities of having or performing with independently the activities of daily living. So what is wearability? The ultimate goal of our research is to provide a symbiosis between the human subject and the robot. So this is a quotation by Lick Leader, then in the 60s, he formulated a vision of human-computer symbiosis. And his vision was based on that. The humans and computers would become fluidly interdependent and share goals. This is exactly what we want to do with human and robot symbiosis. We want that the robot and the human subject become interdependent and share the goal of performing an action, which is in the, our vision is the action of drinking some water, of performing activities of daily living, moving, going to the bathroom, personal hygiene, and so on. So the main three pillars for achieving this objectives. These objectives are wearability, so to provide the safe and comfortable physical human-robot interaction. That means that the mechanism of the robot must be compliant to the biomechanics of the human joints. The second is the natural control. So what we want to achieve is a non-invasive user motion intention detection and gentle assistance. That means that the robot is sharing the goal without any burden of effort for the subject, who must act naturally in the space. The third pillar is the safe interaction. For engineering, safe is important, is fundamental in order to provide reliable system which can be used in the society, in the activities of daily living. And this is an example of lower limb exoskeleton for assisting locomotion and how we can provide this safe interaction. For example, we are working on distributed sensorization of the physical human-robot interface. I will show you what we are doing. So this is the idea of our work. So based on the idea of Schiller, who is the father of modern aesthetics, he wrote that in the age of modern machines, the ultimate goal of aesthetics is to restore harmony, balance, and functionality. So in that sense, the aesthetics of our robot means that we want to provide total functionality for the robot, so the robot must be social and functional. So the exoskeleton, going to our research, starting from human-robot symbiosis and speaking about wearability. So this is NeuroExos, which is a wearable exoskeleton for the elbow. And it took at least 5 years to develop it. And it is an active elbow orthosis, which means that it is external to the arm, and it is a sort of support for normal functionality. And it is for physical rehabilitation and motion assistance. And the basic point are that we, in order to achieve wearability, we need this complex structure with a comfortable system in order to be compliant to the external surface of the human limb. And we have, this is the basic point in order to provide wearability, 4 degrees of freedom, low friction passive mechanism, which is able to follow all the movement of the axis, of the rotation axis of the elbow, in order to follow the biomechanics of the elbow during the normal movement. And the actuation is based on a sort of artificial muscle, and it is based on an antagonist compliant remote actuation, and it works with 2 control systems. One is based on the equilibrium point hypothesis, which is a motor control, human motor control hypothesis. Basically, we have got the idea from neuroscientific models, and we imported this idea in the control system, and when the robot is in charge for moving the arm, we simply control the equilibrium point, which means we change the equilibrium point of the forces acting on the arm, and so the arm is gently moved towards the final target. Or we have also a different system which is tested with the subject but for providing assistance, which is based on providing a torque, a proportional torque, proportional to the intended torque for the user, which is giving additional torque for supporting the action of the user. So we are testing different control systems in different behavioral experiments in order to define what is the main control architecture in order to reach this goal of natural control. So this is only to show you, I don't enter in detail all the mechanisms that are inside, but in order to show you that the simple movement of the rotational axis of the elbow is reproduced by a mechanism which is based on a 4 degrees of freedom mechanism, very complex, but it is providing all the movements that are necessary in order to follow the natural movement of the elbow. And the remote actuation system is based on a sort of artificial muscle, which has been studied separately, and it is based on an hydraulic actuator and a non-linear spring in order to emulate the neuroscientific model describing the function of the muscle and its behavior. And this was really successful for us because we introduced this system by studying and developing this non-linear spring, which in mechanics is a complex mechanism. But we were able to perform these two control strategies that I described before, based on passive compliance control and based on torque control. Thanks to this non-linear behavior of the spring, so which is fundamental in order to implement this agonistic antagonistic control of the elbow. So, and we go also forward, and we are developing the hand exoskeleton, so we will have the hand, the elbow, and the last will be the shoulder, which is the more complicated system. And only to show you how long is the development of such device, we started before the 2009, and now we have the second version of the prototype, which includes the thumb position, so the thumb movement and the index in order to restore and rehabilitate this movement in the hand. With a complex mechanism, we have just published a description which is very, it is based on a system for describing, mathematically describing the self-alignment mechanism, which is one of the base of the pillar of the development of exoskeleton. And this is a very theoretical method which has been developed by one of our PhD students, who is aerospace engineer dedicated to robots. And this is the hand exos. It looks simple, but it is not. A lot of creative work in order to develop this mechanism and to leave free the movement of the subject. So, going back to the second point, the network control. I will show you some recent work, some recent achievements in that area, which are related to, first, to adaptive oscillators for motion assistance. So how we face the problem of controlling without burden and transmitting with, in a non-invasive way the human movement intention to the system. We use a system which is based on an oscillator in order to have the cross-adaptation of the controller to the phase of the movement of the subject, and we performed these experiments in collaboration with the EPFL in Switzerland, in particular with Isbert, and we work on human-robot synchrony. So the problem is to provide an assistant which is in assistance which is in phase with the human intention. So this is the control scheme of the exoskeleton control. So we have a reference which is external, so we provide to the subject a sort of pace, a signal, and the human follow the frequency, so we know exactly the frequency that of the signal for the rhythmic movement. And then there are some sensors on board, and the oscillator is observing the frequency, amplitude, and the offset of the dynamic of the elbow, and is providing data for the torque estimator, and finally in closed loop for the assistive torque, which is fed back to the user. So these are the experiments. I show you part of the video, and so because I want to show you the idea, so this is the angular position of the elbow, and this is the from the biceps and triceps, and you can see here that by providing the assistance, reduction in the effort for the subject, which is our ultimate goal. So we want to show that the global effort for the subject is decreasing thanks to the assistance, which is the objective of our control system. So these are some of the results which are in our papers. It is only to show that the adaptive oscillator tracks the elbow joint angle with no delay. So again, the taking messages that we studied, we implemented in our control system, one model coming from the neuroscience of the lower limb, from the studies on central pattern generator, the oscillator, and we used this mathematical oscillator for our scope, which is totally different. Never mind if the model is not working. What is interesting for us is that that idea provided us a really powerful tool in order to transmit the intention for rhythmic movement from the user to the rod. So now we are working on non-rhythmic movement, and this will be the further step. And this is only to show that coming from no exoskeleton to high assistance, we can see that the linear envelope of the EMG is decreasing. So now we are working on developing better methodologies in order to investigate on the effort for the subject. So it is a biomechanical problem, it is a biological problem, how to measure the effort for the subject and the burden for the subject in wearing and controlling the rod. So, and this is a different application which is related to the meaning of assistance. Despite that the robotics has been, several robotic systems have been developed for personal assistance, so we don't have a clear idea on what is assistance and the physical meaning of assistance. So we try to investigate on how to provide the assistance based on our principle that the user must be satisfactory of the subject and must be happy, and his or her effort must be reduced. So we are focusing our attention on the user adaptability to the different level of assistance. So we developed a system which is based on a simple proportional assistance on the torque on the elbow. And we provide with several gains defined by the subject this assistance, and we look at the ability of the subject of reacting to the assistance and adapting his movement to the assistance. This is an example of the procedure that we used for our behavioral experiments with the exos, and there is the preparation and the gain selection. So the subject increased the gains, which means increase the level of assistance according to their feeling, and then we perform several experiments with variable assistance level from 50% to 150% of the preferred gain previously chosen, and in different movement conditions, and the results are showing us that the position, velocity, and acceleration profiles are not altered by the assistance. This is the important achievement. So a simple assistance, which is the contrary of what in biomechanics in general we are studying, complex model in order to interpreting EMG signals in order to have an idea of the real torque. We are not going to the real torque which is applied by the muscles, we are going to the assistance. We are facing the problem of developing a really usable system, and we provided a system which is only proportional to the linear envelope of the EMG. Very broad idea, but this is providing to the subject some assistance which is useful to reduce the effort. So finally, in this area, the safe interaction. So the safe interaction is based on a hardware system, which is for our system is based on an internal skin. So we are developing artificial skin. I will show you some example. And we had this idea: instead of covering the external part of the robot with the skin, we are covering the internal part. In particular, we are covering the interface between the robot and the user, and at the interface, which are the simple cuff that in rehabilitation therapy are used for connecting the device to the user. And so we developed in collaboration with the colleagues in Twente University a sensorized cuff by modifying their cuff for their lower limb exoskeleton. And we developed this skill sense, which is now is a patent that we are trying to exploit with the spin-off company. And it's a skill which is based on a simple optical sensor. And we are using that for monitoring the distributed interaction between the arm and the axis. Here we have the profile of the pressure distribution at the interface, which is important. It is fundamental to provide comfort for the user, because the pressure must be below a certain threshold in order not to provide damage to the skin of the subject. And also, we want to detect and investigate on the different phases of the interaction by using this data. So this is providing us different data compared to the data that are collected by cameras, the external motion analysis, but because these are internal motion analysis. And these are the similar results that we obtained with the cuff on the lower limb, detecting some increased local pressure that are not measurable with single point force measurements that are traditional in this kind of wearable tool. Finally, we developed with the same skin a sensorized insole, which we are going to use for fall detection. The fall detection for elderly people is an important problem in order to prevent the fall of the elderly and the following impairment for the subject. And this is also used for detecting the different phases of locomotion while wearing this orthoses. And this is the sensor board based on 64 sensors. This is the taxel that we are using. I cannot enter in detail. And this is present prototype that we are going to use for two applications. One is for detecting fall in activities of daily living for elderly subjects. And the second is in conjunction with the lower limb exoskeleton for rehabilitation of the locomotion in subjects with the stroke, so in stroke survivors who are undergoing physical therapy through exoskeletons. So this is the first part on rehabilitation, and now I move to the second part, which is related to prosthetics. And so we change area and we move to functional replacement. This is a motivation for us. So we want to restore for a subject with amputation of upper limb the ability of using his hand, or in that case his hand, in activities of daily living. These are electrodes and detectors for stimulation of the skin. This is a subject from Sweden. We are performing experiments in Lund. And this is our hand with a Lund controller and a Lund subject. And so he is happy of trying this hand. So this is the motivation for us. And we are developing artificial hands since 1999. And in particular, we have three lines. One is based on prosthetic development, and now we have a new generation of prosthetic hands, which we call low-cost prosthetic hand, very simple, and hopefully for the market also of development countries. And we have also this very simple hand, which is a very simple and low-cost hand with a specific patent, which is based on silicone. And then we have the third research line, which is intended to develop hands for humanoid robot. And we have this open hand, which is a new generation of hand we developed 2 years ago. And now it is tested in different labs around the world, in Japan, in Tsukuba, in ETH, in Zurich, in America, at Johns Hopkins, and in different labs, where because our idea is to send our hand in order to try test it with different controller, and different experimental environments. So the in that case, the objective is to have a brain-controlled hand, which means that we have a simple drawing showing that we want to decode the intention for the subject, and decode it and send the commands to the hand. And also we want to encode the interaction of the hand with the environment and provide sensory feedback to the subject and hopefully closing the loop. So the scientific and technological effort in order to reach this goal are different. We have research which we call mechatronic, which is a synonymous of robotics, which means the hardware development, mechanisms, sensors, power, actuation, control in a standalone prosthetic hand. And we have also worked on the user prosthesis interface, which is the bridge between the hand and the user brain and the user body. And what are the main problems? The main problem is that the requirements for the hand are set by the interface performance. So if we have a slow interface, we will have a non-performant hand, even if the hand is sophisticated, we are not able to control it. On the contrary, if the interface is complex, and if the interface reaches high performance, we know that we can evaluate it only with a smart hand device. So the two areas are connected, and the main research issues that we are facing are related to body ownership, which is related to symbiosis, but the idea is that the hand is included in the body schema and is part of the body and is felt part of the body. The behavioral studies that are connected with that, testing different hands and looking at what the subject is feeling and what the subject is able to do. The user assessment, what the subject wants. What does the subject want? And the vocational therapy, which means that with the hand is a tool for working. So it's important to have a rehabilitation to the previous vocational activity of the subject. So it is connected to the keyboard or to different tools that have been to be used by the subject. And the activities of daily living, so autonomy in performing the main activities of daily living, nutrition, personal hygiene, and entertainment, and social activities, and so on. And so we have three main challenges. And one is that the robotic hand must be able to perform dexterous actions and sense objects. The second is related to the interface for controlling perception and action. And we are focused on non-invasive interface and on interfaces which are connected to the peripheral nervous system. In particular, what we want to achieve is an interface which is bidirectional. So that means that the interface must decode the user intention and also encode the environment data in order to provide feedback. And without this bidirectionality, the interface will not be perfect. And the third, which is the future perspective, is the sense of body ownership. And one of my former postdoc, now assistant professor, is working basically on that, on the sense of body ownership. This is only to show the main problems, because we have a lot of critical issues. So we have issues that are related to intelligent mechanisms. So one of the assistant professors who is working on that is a mechanical engineer, and we have several mechanical and aerospace engineers working on that, because the problems are related to big drivability of mechanisms, adaptive mechanisms, and different prensile patterns and allow manipulation. And we have also control people working on the microelectronics and control and embedded control, working on low-level control on feedback delivery. And we have also the control issues, which are related to how to divide and share the responsibility of performing the task between the standalone controller in the hand and the user intention. So this is history, our smart hand, and so now it can be included in the globe, and we performed a lot of experiments. So the experiments that I am going to show you basically are done with this smart hand, which is the result of a European project. This is the open hand, so this is the last generation. And I'm sorry it's in Italian, but the main point is that we have a novel fingertip, which is compliant, and we are investigating on the biomaterials for developing the fingertip, which is the most important part of the hand for increasing the ability of grasping different objects. And so we have a couple of biomedical engineers working on this area, developing the appropriate material for that. And we have a novel mechanism inside, and okay, you are not interested in the performance of the hand, but this is a picture for the hand which is commercial. So we have a spin-off company producing this hand for the labs.
No, che lo posizione del pollice.
Quindi le ultime due dita si muovono insieme,
leggera.
Sì, poi avete messo anche allora questi cavetti qua che io vedo sopra, in realtà quindi sono i tendini.
Sì, sì, il funzionamento è abbastanza simile. Sono
questa mano può anche questo bicchiere adesso non lo spacca.
No, non lo spacca. Infatti io posso.
Scusami, vai.
Infatti noi possiamo scegliere il livello di forza da applicare sull'oggetto. E quindi possiamo fare delle prese più alte, allora mettiamo un po' più di forza in modo che prenda l'oggetto più peso. Veramente si può.
È veramente incredibile, guarda. Allora, questa abbiamo detto che è la presa interessa due dita. Proviamoci subito con questo.
Proviamo. Eccolo.
Guardalo. Guarda con che precisione lo prende e poi
con 3D
digitale come questo.
Esatto,
l'uovo non è facile.
Okay. Vediamo se si spacca.
Fantastico, veramente fantastico. Questa cilindrica venisse presa con una forza troppo grande si schiaccerebbe, invece no, incredibile. E per quanto riguarda invece, come stai facendo tu adesso
esatto,
per tenere il martisco?
Stiamo.
Anche
this grasp, the lateral grasp is fundamental for
copione di oggi,
for the credit card, which is important for paying in restaurants. Okay. And so the interface. So how to put in the loop the human subject. There is a lot of research. It is not my main area, so I will not. Maybe for neuroscientists, it is the most important area. But for me, it's important. But my main task is to provide the hand, and the interfaces can be classified in non-invasive, low-invasive, and invasive. And I highlighted only the area where we are working. And basically, our idea is to explore non-invasive as far as possible, because we think that before going to implant a neural interface, we have to exploit the signals that are available without invasivity in the human body. So we have biosignal interfaces, so EEG, EMG, sensory substitution system, which means a system for providing back the feedback to the subject, electrotactile, vibrotactile, and pressure. And Christian Cipriani is working on vibrotactile and pressure very much. He is also publishing several papers on that. And we have also other interfaces, foot interface, tongue interface, and the LAOGI signals from the eye interface, and for invasive signals we are collaborating with a Chinese group for the CNS interface, and they are using our hand, and we are going into this area, the peripheral nervous system interfaces, because we think that this is a good compromise between invasivity and performance, because this kind of interface are also producing a bidirectional link, which means that the same interface in the peripheral nervous system can be used for decoding signals from the central nervous system, but also to stimulate the nervous fiber for providing feedback to the user. And so we are doing experiments in Rome for that. So now I show you some different experiments only to give an overview of the different area. So staying into this idea of sending away the hand with the postdoc, we did a lot of work in collaboration with Lund University. This was very successful because there was a hand surgeon who was a famous hand surgeon with a lot of experience and very fond of this at the end of his career and stimulating a lot of work with the implants with the people, and because he thinks that non-invasive system must be exploited. And this is an idea of how the skin of the subject is stimulated with actuators, and this is a subject trying to teach to the neural controller the intention and to connect the signal from the intention, which is sent by moving with the glove of the hand, to the EMG recorded in the stump of the subject. So it is a classical learning experiment. And we also exploited from neuroscience, neurophysiology, some special models. In particular, we tried to implement the work by Santello and Flanders, who demonstrated that control of hand posture involves a few postural synergies, regulating the general shape of the hand, and coupled with a finer control mechanism, which provided small adjustments. So the idea of synergies and the principal component analysis performed by Santello was also imported in our system. And we implemented in collaboration with Pavia, with the University of Pavia, and colleagues who are focused on signal analysis, we implemented this principal component analysis. And the result is that with a two-channel EMG and this control algorithm, we were able to start from a plane in the XY signal, we were able to move from an open hand to the different postures of the hand, so the main grasp, lateral grasp, pinch, and cylindrical grasp, by simply moving on the intensity of the signals on the two movements. So these are the movements that are recorded on the subject, so abduction, adduction, and flexion, extension of the wrist. And the second approach was tested in Belgrade, so we made a sort of call for colleagues working on signal processing and different interfaces, and we had several good responses, in particular here with Dr. Popovic, who is one of the fathers of biomedical engineering, and in Belgrade and in Aalborg, and we worked on this system, which assists the controller of the hand by using a simple camera that is shown in this sketch, and the camera is on the hand and is able to detect the affordance, which means the main parameters for the pre-shaping of the hand. So the user has not any burden for the tech for connecting to the hand and defining the pre-shaping, and it is automatically driven by the camera in the hand. Finally, our last, I am honorary professor in Zhejiang University, where we sent our hands and postdoc also, and we are working in Anzhou, which is a nice city, one of the best in China, with a lake. So I recommend you Anzhou, and which is much better than Beijing and Shanghai, because there is a nice weather and no pollution. And It is a good university where we try to start up a team working on neural interface and on signal processing. And here we developed with Mr. now Dr. Howe a system which is based on electrophotography signals, and in particular, you know that better than me that in the natural system the affordance selection is based on visual estimation of properties and on the motor phase. This is only a schematic drawing of what we are doing, and in our system we are using for affordance selection the movement of the eye in exploring the object, and this was really successful, a lot of work, because we really started up a group, a team, and we trained people, and I think this was for the best, because now we have a very good group in biomedical engineering in Zhejiang University, and they have a lot of money for performing experiments. So, and now they are also working on CNS control, and they are working with John Donoghue, who is also honorary professor in Zhejiang, and they are using their interfaces and our hand in order to make this affordance selection. So their area is the selection of affordance with different invasive interfaces in order to provide the ability of controlling the pre-shaping. So you know that for the reaching phase of the hand is the most important is the pre-shaping of the hand according to the object properties. So it is fundamental this to connect this affordance selection to the motor appropriate motor command for the hand, which must open in time compared to the time for reaching the object, and must prepare, because if this pre-shaping phase is failing, the object cannot be grasped successfully. So it is really a good point to start to investigate to this phase, and now we are able to synchronize our motor commands with the real object properties and the expected object properties, and also to introduce a loop in the control system for unexpected event like slippage or similar, or if the properties are not matching the visual appearance of the object. So that is the most interesting part that I suggest to young neuroscientists to study, in conjunction with robotics, of course, because the main to work on a robotic hand and a robotic system can offer some novel stimuli in order to develop a better theory of the motor control. So there is also feedback on neuroscience based on the experience with robots in terms of ideas, concept, and creativity. So the last part is on touch sensing, and then I finish my presentation. It is because on touch sensing we are collaborating with Matthew Diamond, and hopefully in the future, if our project will be approved, we will go forward. We have some. Calogero, Oddo, who is now assistant professor, maybe one of the youngest in Italy. This is the idea. So, starting in 2008, we developed a micro load cell, which is the basic mechanoceptor for our artificial skin. And this is the biomimetic finger tip, and it is based on this microsensor that we are developing since many, many years. And it is only to show that engineering is very slow, it's really slow, in order to develop this integrated system. And we integrated this basic load cell in an array of cells, trying to emulate some properties of the mechanoceptors in the human skin. We also packaged this array with soft skin with ridges. And we are investigating also on the material, so basically the idea is to study the structure of human hand skin and the mechanoceptors and the density, the response time, the frequency of spiking, and how these mechanoreceptors are synchronized with the event of grasping an object, touching a system. I must say that this work and our knowledge is based on our relation since many years with Roland Johansson in Umeå University and Benedin in Umeå in Sweden, and also with other colleagues and neurophysiologists from Göteborg in Sweden, because it is really only with the interaction of neurophysiologists that we had this idea of which properties are really important. So, for engineering, the basic task is to identify the priorities in developing the system, because it is not simple to replicate the human finger. By working with neurophysiologists, for us, we understood which are the main properties that must be transferred to our system. So I try to go fast because I know that it's a long time and a long presentation. So basically, we are studying passive and active touch with different, and also the morphology of the ridges by making different experiments. And we are focusing on this classification of textures, and in particular, so we have the pick and lift task, so picking and lifting an object, and the second task is classification of the texture of different samples. And we work with Göran Westberg in Göteborg in Sweden. And finally, we are now working with Lugano in Switzerland for developing artificial curiosity, only to show you the frontier of what we are doing. So the basically the typical classification is based on the input processing by machine learning, and then the output surface property. And we want to go from pre-programmed touch trajectories towards curiosity-driven exploration, which means that the active movement of the finger under the sample is also subject to the machine learning. So the final loop is this. So we have an input, a processing system, and the classes of different properties, and also the movement of the finger. So we are also making an optimization of the finger movement in order to drive the action of the finger. And this is the result, that after many and many trials, the robot learn to tap and to investigate the texture of the surface with a human-like movement, okay? Which demonstrates nothing, but it's wonderful to see. So the future, we have a specific roadmap for neuromorphic peptide sensing. So first the array, second the neural engineering, so the neural interface for detecting the peripheral nervous system signals. Third, the neuroprosthetics, so using computational neuroscience in order to anticipate the grasp, the movement, and to connect to the controller. For the humanoid neurorobotics, so to develop a complete system to emulate touch sensing in order to develop a layered architecture for the touch. And finally, the neuromorphic ICT architectures for processing the information. So finally, the future perspective are related to people. So I am also grateful to them. So these are the assistant professors working with me, Christian, who is working on bidirectional interfaces, minimally invasive interfaces, and body ownership. And he learned how to work with a neuroscientist, Nicola. I didn't find the picture on Nicola, but this is Nicola Vitiello. He is working on neuroskeleton. Calogero is working on neuromorphic touch. And Marco Controzzi is a mechanical engineer and is developing his own company, selling hands, and also is working on biomaterials and control. Finally, this is their knowledge. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much for your very interesting presentation. I have a few curiosities I'd like to ask you, and maybe at the end an unfair question. So the curiosities are the following. So you showed the middle part of your talk, halfway through, you showed all these robots that are basically patients wear. So how heavy are they? Can they be worn normally, or are they heavy or uncomfortable? And the other thing is, I'd like to ask you with respect to those robots you showed. Do you have any, are you aware of any study that has been done comparing the effects of this kind of rehabilitation with other types of rehabilitation, for instance, using virtual reality, whether one is better than the other. And concerning rehabilitation with these robots again, do you know whether there is already a known schedule? So how long do they need to be used for, do you have to keep them on all the time, or things like that? So these kind of questions. And the unfair question is the following. So concerning the hands you showed, this is a completely different problem, because clearly you are providing a limb or a hand to somebody who doesn't have one. So in this case, you have to provide the hand with all the features you described very clearly. But take, for instance, patients who do have brain damage and they have problems in what you described, opening the hand before they go to grasp, the hand grasps the object, which you said that it's necessary in order to successfully grasp the object. So how do you think robotics can help in this case?
Cognitive problem, you mean?
Well, problems in motor problems, like in patients with stroke who have superior parietal cortex and they suffer from optical atrophy, for instance. So I wonder, I'm not aware of how robotics can help in that case. Thank you very much.
Okay. I hope to remember everything. So starting from the weight of the robot is still too high, and that means that we are working on reducing the total weight by using special materials and similar. For the moment, I can divide it in different parts, because rehabilitation is not related to the weight of the robot, because the subject is connected for the therapy, which means once per day or two times per week or similar, goes to the robot and performs some reaching movement, which is related to your last question. So the idea is that there is a faster motor recovery by performing the reaching movement assisted by the robot, and this is demonstrated by several data. And compared to the traditional physiotherapy, what we know now is that at least the robotic therapy is able to provide the same results of the physical therapy. So it is not better for therapy, for delivering therapy. What is better is that we can record data, we can perform multi-site experiments, and we can automate the we can speed up the rehabilitation process by putting several robots in parallel with a single therapist supervising several robots delivering the therapy. So if you go, for example, close to Milano, where there are several facilities for rehabilitation, the clinical sites, and you can see that now the place where the rehabilitation therapy is delivered is based on several machines, virtual reality, robots, exoskeleton, and manipulators, even video games in parallel, and a few therapists are supervising and putting the data of the subject and doing the system. So this is good for delivering the therapy to a lot of people. And if we are able to obtain and to achieve the same results, we are very good with robots. Of course, there will be time for improving, but for the moment, the data are showing us that we, with several collection and experiments, we are at the same level. Especially for the upper limb, which is much more mature than the lower limb. On the lower limb, there is a lot of discussion on different approaches and different therapies, because the axis is really big and huge and heavy, and for the user to enter in the axis is really a slow process, which is also providing some fatigue and burden for the therapist and for the subject. So the goal is to provide a light up axis, and for the moment the state of the art is not good, because the robots are very expensive and maybe not natural in providing the good locomotion pattern. For example, there is the problem of sagittal movement. If you reduce all the movement for lower limbs in the sagittal planes, you are omitting a lot of natural movement. And for example, if you put the model here, the arms will be like that, or will be still during movements, and this is not natural, and also we can see from experiments that there is a lot of effort paid in order to keep still and not swinging the arm. So this is an open area, and we are working now on that. I didn't show any results because it is really not mature. There are some commercial robots. I don't recommend to use those robots, but patients want to use the robot. So sometimes it happens that private clinics are buying robots in order to provide some illusion for the subject to have a response to his or her problem. So this is the point. So for people with impairment, with amputation, the problem is to provide a good hand in performing tasks and a simple interface with no burden. Because if they have to pay attention to the hand and what is the movement that I need to do? This is not good. Or if another problem is related to the noise, if the hand is doing like that, this movement of the motor, so the hand will be thrown away. For the rehabilitation, it is already demonstrated that it's good for subjects, so there is a sort of motor learning which is connected to the use of the manipulator or the exoskeleton in performing task, in reaching task in the plane. So we know that it is part of, and it is only a transfer of the physical therapy from the human physiotherapist, from the human plus the robot. I don't know if I answered to your question.
I have a quick question, curiosity. You talked about touch, and so is there an identified role for the fingertips in touch? I find this intriguing because touch is universal, and fingertips are individual marks. So I find this very interesting.
Yes. You have to read the papers by Roland Johansson, who worked in Umeå University, Sweden. He worked on fingertip, and so you can find a lot of behavioral experiments. I will give you the name of the references. So, neurophysiology showed that the fingertip is fundamental for detecting the object properties, for learning the to control the affordance, and for providing all data for motor control of the manipulation. So. And we know that the fingertip is important. Not only the mechanoreceptors included in the fingertip, but also the skin properties, which means the conformance of the skin to the object. So the ability to detect the shape, for example, the border and the curvature radius of the object is a combination of the properties of the skin, the biomechanical properties of the skin, which means the ability to conform to the shape and the compliance to the force applied and the impedance connected to the movement, and their firing of mechanoreceptors. It is this combination that is providing the ability of moving the finger and performing fine manipulation, which is completely different from pick and lift, where the mechanoreceptors are giving a sort of event detection, which means that the mechanoreceptors are firing, some mechanoreceptors are firing in conjunction with the contact phase or sleeping phase, and so the combination of the different frequency of the mechanoreceptor firing is giving us some event detection, which is necessary in order to change from position control in reshaping to a force control, for example, in grasping. So there is a switching of modality which is controlled by the connection of mechanoreceptors to the motor intention. So the fingertip in all of this action is fundamental. So what we must emulate is the properties of mechanoreceptor to fire in different cases, for example, to have a fast reaction to contact, or to have a slow reaction to conformance of the to the subject surface or similar. So we have to reproduce the functionality of the different mechanoreceptors which are in the fingertip. So the other part are also important, but basically with very low functionality, like contact for adjusting the grasp or similar. So are important, but not essential in the final grasping performance. So it's but if you read the papers that I can provide you, you can have a lot of hints on that.
Thank you very much. My question is about getting information from the skin into the nervous system
and
into the nervous system, into the brain. And you showed that that you're working hard on making different kinds of receptors in the artificial skin. The laboratories that you're working with in Sweden are very famous for showing that that sensory nerve fibers have very specific properties. They have labels according to what kind of receptor they're connected to. So the question is whether you think that in order to make an interpretable message for the brain, different receptors in the skin would have to be connected to exactly the right kind of fiber, or would the brain learn to interpret signals even if they were connected onto the wrong track?
This is a very difficult question. I cannot answer. I think we have to try the both strategies, okay? Maybe. What we want to reproduce is a model, I don't have the picture, drawn by Johansson on the different time for reaching for the signal, firing signal for coming from the event detection to the central nervous system, which means that maybe with a combination and working on the timing, we will be able to provide different information to the central nervous system. So we are much more primitive compared to what you are saying. For the moment, we want to try to emulate this ability of, with the similar mechanoreceptors and the similar channels, which means that the carrier is the same, try to work on the timing, because timing is fundamental in order to set the and to move, to switch from different control modalities in order to control the hand. So we are much more primitive. Of course, if we will work on neuromorphic touch, we will try to both strategies, to have specialized control unit for some mechanoreceptors, and to try to investigate if this is possible. For the moment, we are more working on the timing, which is really a challenge for engineers, because we have few milliseconds for doing everything in order to be good in controlling the hand. I don't know if I have answered to the question.
Related to the one that Diane did just now, which is how wide is the contact in this interface situation? If I'm not wrong, you take mainly information from the periphery.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, in an action, for instance, taking the bottle and lifting, there are many peripheral things that enter. One is the size of the bottle, and the other one is the weight of the bottle, because it's a totally different peripheral information, which in general the central nervous system joins together. The question is, how wide is your integration system, even in the thing that you showed us in the slide, which is taking the bottle of lift, which has to integrate different peripheral information?
Yes, yes, it is a very good question. The point is that we have to define a priority, which means that some actions must be done by the hand with a local controller. So some information will not provide to the user, which means not fed into the neural interface, for which is different from what Matthew was saying, because from one side there is research on neuromorphic control, from one side there is, on the other side there is research on for providing to a subject the feedback, the sensory feedback. So for the subject, what is important and is that we don't know exactly how proprioception is built. So we, at the moment, from what I know from papers, but I'm not a neurophysiologist, but we don't know exactly what proprioception means. And even neurophysiologists, for example, Benedin in Sweden is fighting with other neurophysiologists, because everybody has his own idea of proprioception. If you read on Kandel some basic ideas, but now the field is growing, is mutating. We don't have, at least as an engineer, I don't have a clear picture of what is. So what we have to do is to perform experiments by giving simple signals. So even the contact signal, we provide it by some stimulation external. In the future, with the peripheral nervous interface, we provide a stimulus, which is a sort of electric pulse to the nervous fiber, and we have to ask to the subject what he is feeling. Okay? Because we are not able to close the loop for the moment. Okay, with the animal, we don't know exactly, we cannot know what is proprioception. So, the reason why we are going to make implants is to have subjects aware of what we are doing in the loop of the experiments and to ask to the subject what the subject is feeling. So, this is for proprioception. For exteroception, it is completely different. We have to be pragmatic and give a feedback which is useful for the grasping task. So now we are focusing on the pick and lift and try to provide the same event which are described in the Johansson model, which means the first signal which is related to the contact, the second signal which is related to the contact between the object and the table, the third signal, which is related to the lifting the object, and so on. So very simple signal with electric pulse. So we are very much primitive in that sense.
Yeah, okay? So in the interface, each signal takes information from a different thing, or you are also entering somehow in a more central, coordinated mixing of signals.
So in the peripheral nervous system interface, we have eight channels. We don't know exactly where we are, and we know that we are in contact with
peripheral nervous fibers, and what we do is to stimulate and make a sort of empirical analysis of what the subject is feeling. So basically it's working with a blind subject. We don't know exactly where we are. So in that sense we are primitive, because we cannot say we hope that the subject will learn better with this internal stimulation, which is a sort of electric pulse in a single point, in a single fiber, we don't know exactly where, in the middle of the arm, of the nerve. So, and we know that we have 8 channels, a low frequency, so we can provide some simple stimuli. And what we want to do is not to control the performance of the hand, but to provide some signals in order to enhance proprioception and the involvement of the subject in the loop without paying attention to the hand. So I cannot go forward because basically we are in the stone age.
Thank you.
Let me go a little bit to the future then, from Stone Age. I was intrigued by all the grasping that you are investigating with the colleague in China, but most of the examples that you gave are basic independent movement that you are trying to achieve with one independent hands. And I was wondering about movement and action that involve both hands, supposedly. One that is a natural hand, and one that is supplied by the mechanical tool. And my curiosity is, do you see that as a special class of action? And if so, what do you envision the major issue in implementing those kind of support for the people?
Yes. We are also in that area. We are in the Stone Age because now we are focusing on a single end and not on the both and bimanual tasks. Even if we know, for example, in rehabilitation for stroke survival, we are focusing on a single hand, and very few machines and therapists are working on the bimanual, which is much more important. But I think that this is a sort of for therapy is. Sort of a drawback of physiology. The idea is to work and to separate the effect. So let's start with the hand and try to understand everything a single hand and then put the second hand. If you are not sure with a single hand, don't put a second hand, which complicates very much the work. And also there is a problem of hemiplegia because you want to stimulate the use of the subject in using the paralyzed hand and not to use the good hand. So you try to put the focus on the single hand movement, even in parallel with the other one, but trying to discourage the use of the normal hand. So this is in therapy. But for the bimanual task, for example, in robotics, this is a mechanical engineering problem which is much more complicated because you have two hands in parallel performing the same task and you have to control separately, but you have also to connect the two controllers in real time. And this is a real time problem. It is a timing problem which is complex because you have because the events in manipulation are less than 1 millisecond, so the main the time which is relevant, and it is very difficult to have two controllers in parallel in real time working that fast because of the inertia of the system. The mechanism inertia is slowing everything. You have a big and heavy movements of the hand providing slow movements, and to put real time and to anticipating the dynamics of two arms in parallel is really difficult. And so the bimanual task in robotics are studied now, but are novel. It's a novel area that we are developing. And what we use and we used to study is by manual task done by a robot, the object and the human hand. So how to assist with the robot, robotic hand, the human hand in carrying an object or doing manipulation. This is a very much interesting area. For the neurophysiological studies, for the moment we are concentrated for amputation is concentrated on a single hand because they have a natural hand. So if they are bilateral amputees, they still want one hand which is much more performant than the others. And for quadriplegic is totally different because you have really a simple bridge and you want to control the task. It is not possible for the moment to imagine a bimanual task. And for the monkey, the monkey still has his own hand. So the controller is able to detect the movements, but we don't cut the hand to the monkey. So the monkey is moving his hand. Our controller is acting in parallel. And it is concentrated on the single hand. I think that for the moment, due to the primitive status of the interface, it is not possible to think to implant maybe a double implant and to control also the other hand.
Hi. About the brain-machine interfaces, so devices to implant in the brain of humans, perhaps in motor cortex or premotor cortex, like paraplegic patients. Some scientists think that by now it is not ethically acceptable to do that yet, because the technology is not advanced enough to really provide real relief, real help, and it's actually a dangerous surgery, because you are opening the brain and put this back in the brain. But some people are doing that, right? There was like a Nature cover, like I think 2002, 2004, with the patient implanted by, I think, the tomography. And I just wanted to know your opinion about this. If you think that this kind of experiments in humans should be carried on, or it is too soon?
I don't like this kind of implants in humans, but I recognize that at the end the subject is happy. So this is the reason why I try to be provoke your reaction by showing the video at the beginning of the presentation. So what John Donoghue, who is the scientist that I know better working in this area, said that the subjects are asking for that. So if the cognitive abilities of the subjects are intact, and provided that you have a protocol which is shared with the subject, and the subject is aware of what you are doing, in the case of quadriplegia, you can do that. Of course, the results are very simple. For example, by moving the eye, you can provide the same signal for moving the hand. So this kind of experiments are done for research, which means for having data and in future having cortical interfaces which are more performant. Without experiments in that particular area, as I said before, without experiments, we don't know what the subject is feeling, so we will never know. And we can use animals, of course, but not for body ownership research and for that research. For peripheral nervous system implants, I performed an implant in collaboration with colleagues in Rome, and we had a very tough ethical committees, and we were required to explain to the subject each step of the intervention, all details of the engineering part and everything, and to be very clear on the expectations for the subject. So, and this was known, it was an implant for 1 month, so it was not a chronic implant, and in the peripheral nervous system, so not so invasive. Personally, I'm collaborating with people like in China, but it is more to try to define good protocols because they were working on their own, and so we decided to collaborate in order to have a sort of transfer of knowledge. But in my lab, I don't want to make experiments. for with neural interfaces. I don't like that. And I, as you have seen in all my presentation, especially Christian, but also Calogero and Nicola, Marco is doing the experiments in China, so I cannot say that, but the others are all pushing for non-invasive interfaces and trying to define, to make as much, as many tests as possible in order to evaluate to which extent we can provide a good interface without any invasive implant in human subjects.
Okay, I think we can close. We are out of time. So I would like to thank you, Professor Carrozza, in the name of all SISSA.
Thank you for the beautiful talk. For survivors.